Welcome to my channel. Just a quick note on the photo you were looking at. This was taken in July of 1977. My youngest son, who was only a few days old, and I were sitting in our living room on Sand Island in the Midway Atoll. The little guy had been born in Tripler Army Hospital, 1,305 miles away in Honolulu, Hawaii. Midway Island didn't have great medical facilities, and just in case there were complications, they sent mothers off to Hawaii to have their babies. I fortunately was there for the delivery, and so we all flew back home together. Mom took the picture of this INTJ dad and his son. I had on my trusty old fishing hat, even though I never went fishing with it. The poor child had no idea what was to come as he was listening to his pa. There are a lot of things written about being an INTJ parent. Some of it I can relate to very strongly. Most of it, really. I'm looking back at what I did as a father and what I continue to do. I am now also a grandfather, but that has enough uncommon ground with being a dad that I may make a separate video of that one day. For an INTJ, as is no doubt true for any personality type, what types your children are will have a lot to do with the meshing you will have with your children's view of the world. I have seen how hard it is for an outgoing extrovert to try and understand her introverted daughter. In fact, the other day, I had gone through a long description how wonderful it is that an introverted teen has a super friend who is also introverted. I had been discussing this with an extrovert, and she replied, "But it would be great if she had a less introverted friend so she could learn to be more outgoing." It was a head-slapping moment. Extroverts just don't get it that they are not in sole possession of the right way to do things, and introverts are not doing it wrong. Take a Celtic musical duo group, and one plays violin and the other plays the Irish whistle. The violin player sings the vocals. These two members of the group are doing different things, but which one is doing it right? An introvert lives his life in a way that is internal by definition. An extrovert lives his life externally. Neither of them is 100% either internal or external, but they both have a different preference for how to spend their time. The one who is doing it right is the one who finds the greatest joy in life for himself. That means that he might very well be doing quite different things and still be doing it right for himself. Introverts see this easily, but many extroverts simply can't get it. As parents with an introverted child, many extroverts wring their hands in worry and fear that their poor introverted child is broken and needs to change. This is a grave mistake, and I have discussed this in the INTJ child. If you are such a parent, please view that video for the sake of your child. Today, I'm going to be looking at things from the introverted side of parenting and how to deal with children who are not INTJs. If you are blessed with an INTJ child, you are fortunate indeed because you will have a friend for life, I am sure. Otherwise, you will have your work cut out for you as you move through the years of trying to raise children who will have needs and wants that are different than your own, sometimes radically so. Looking back, it is easy to see the flaws in what I did in my parental years when my sons were at home with us. It is not easy to see how I could have avoided a lot of what happened, though. Love was never a problem, and I think my boys always knew that I loved them. They knew that I cared about them. They know that today. As far as I know, neither of my sons have taken a personality test. The subject appears to not interest them. If they have taken a personality test, they have not shared the results with me. But based upon their method of facing the world, I would guess that my older son is an ESTP, and the younger one is an ISTJ. My elder son has always been expressive of his feelings. He is warm and eager to interface, but he is also eager to be out doing things. He is now 46 years old, but he snowboards and plays softball and is still going strong. When we are together, it is always fun and intense, but when we are not, we can have very long periods of time where we have no contact at all because he is about his life and I am about mine. My younger son physically lives much closer, and I see him more often, but he has always emotionally been far closer to my wife, because their personalities match very well. She is an amazing person and fun to be around, and my son was with her a lot of the time when I was at work. Sometimes I was gone for months at a time on a cruise in the Navy. The same thing that makes my younger son close to my wife has also led to some bumpy spots with the older boy because he is the same type as my wife. They had their own view of how things should be and were both eager to express it. There's a whole backstory to the situation in which my kids were raised, but I'm not going to go into that here. I joined the Navy as a family-based choice, and after 13 years of service, I got out of the Navy as a family-based decision. My older boy was getting well into his teens, and he was too much for my wife to handle when I was at sea, and my younger boy was just entering his teens. Well, my family needed Dad to be at home, and for this Dad, his family was always number one. My older boy and I share a love of playing sports, and when we see each other, we tend to do as much of that as this old man can handle. For example, the last time he came for a visit, we went to a batting cage, and the machine had a manual feed for the baseballs. My son is a powerfully built man, and he plays softball in several leagues and travels to various countries in Asia playing in tournaments. He can hit a ball far harder than I ever could, even in my prime. Well, I fed in a ball to the machine, and he got all of it and sent that fastball screaming right back at me. Fortunately, even in my 60s, I still have my reflexes. I wasn't really expecting it, so all I could do was get my glove up and stop the ball. I was disappointed that I dropped it, but my son was so shaken by the fact that he had almost killed his dad, he couldn't even hit the next couple of pitches. My younger boy was really into basketball when he was in junior high and high school. We played a lot of one-on-one back then. My two sons still have good games when they get together. I play, but these days I'm more of an observer while they do the hard work. There's a difference in desire to do sports, though. The older boy is strongly driven to play and to win, while my younger son plays more to have fun. But he still wins his share of games. It doesn't seem to matter as much, though. What I know for sure is that I always have fun when my boys are around. It is unfortunate that kids don't come with a technical manual the way electronic equipment does. I could, for example, go to the Navy tech manual for a high-frequency transmitter and learn what is the right procedure to use in order to deal with a malfunction. With kids, I had to figure it out on the fly. And kids are not unfeeling electronics equipment. They have emotions and needs, and no technical manual can cover that. As a father, I was tasked with doing the right thing, even when the right thing was not obviously so. What did I do when my sons strayed from the path my wife and I had laid before them? I reasoned with them. I spent uncounted hours discussing the rules, showing my extroverted son logical reasons why those rules were in place. I handed to him all the things that I would have needed to understand in order to obtain my cooperation if the positions were reversed. It appeared to do no good whatsoever at the time. But later, when he was in his 30s, he said that he had heard every word that I said, and he thanked me for all the time that I invested into his understanding about life. You could have knocked me over with a feather when he told me that. My younger son, being introverted, was less prone to stray outside of the rules, since his inclinations were more internal than looking outwardly for fun. He played with his friends, of course, but he was not eager to do things that we would object to. Since they have both become men, I have many times told my sons that I wish I had been able to do a better job in their younger days. They have both indicated that they thought I did a great job. While I honestly feel I did my absolute best to be a good father, there are areas I wish I could have done better. For example, I wish I had read to them more rather than just providing books for them to read themselves. I found when my mother read to me that created a desire to read, and I think I could have done a better job on that for my sons. I remember the few times where I really had fun memories of my own father, and I wanted to give my own sons lots of those memories. When I was a preteen, my dad once took me out into the yard and taught me how to throw and catch a football. Later on, he went with me to the park with a couple of my friends and played baseball. These were very uncommon events. My mother was far more likely to go and play ball with me with my friends than my father was. He was not sports-oriented. This is why when I was around 14 and our church had a father-son baseball game scheduled, I wasn't even going to ask Dad to play because I knew he wouldn't want to. He wasn't a member of the church, and he didn't like sports. Mom told me I should ask him anyway, and much to my surprise, he said yes. I was shocked, and I was overjoyed. I will forever treasure the memory of that game. I remember how happy I was whenever my father would spend time with me. I wanted to give that to my sons. I worked hard on that, and we did lots of sports-related things together. I spent time, invested a great deal of thought, and I talked with my sons often. I removed temptation to do the wrong thing wherever I reasonably could while not making prisoners of them. I wanted them to learn to use freedom constructively, and I would reward their good behavior with increased freedom to act independently. I was trying to build up to the day when they would be completely free to act as they saw fit when they stepped into adult life. But children are not logical machines, and they cannot be shaped into electronic circuits where results can be easily predicted. They are living, thinking, feeling beings with minds of their own. They are not good candidates for a science experiment, where you do certain things and get predictable results. And then they grow up, and they go out on their own path at some point, and all you can do is hope that you gave them enough to work with in the future. In an odd sort of way, being an INTJ dad is like giving a puzzle to a mind that loves solving puzzles, but there is no right solution. Whatever you do may or may not produce good results. At least for this INTJ, it was a very troubling problem. I grew up with a huge wall between my father and myself. He was introverted, and I wouldn't be surprised at all if he was an INTJ. But he was also an alcoholic, and so I never got to know him the way I would have loved to. I spent most of my time avoiding him because he was not a happy drunk. In fact, he died at age 45 in a propane explosion that was related to his inebriation. I was 21 at the time, and Dad died 2 days after my older boy's first birthday. It was a horrible thing. Dad was burned over 80% of his body, and what killed him was the fact that he had inhaled the propane and his lungs were burned. He survived about 24 hours after the accident. Sober, my father was the finest man I ever knew. He was brilliant, honest, and loving. But as the years went by, he was less and less sober and more drunk. One of my happiest moments was when, right around my 15th birthday, I was sent off to a religious boarding school. One of the things I swore to myself was that I would never put my family through the horrors of alcoholism. I drank very little alcohol during my life. But I also focused on those wonderful memories I had when Dad was sober, and I tried my best to recreate those types of things with my kids. But there was still that wall. I had no model for day-to-day interfacing with my father. It was terribly hard for me to break through and be the father that my father wasn't. My older boy, being extroverted, just pushed through the wall and wouldn't be denied. But my younger son was introverted, and it was up to me, and I feel I failed more than I should have. But even after all these years, I'm not sure what I could have done to fix it. He is not an INTJ, and he doesn't love learning for learning's sake, and I can put him to sleep if I get too deep into things for too long. He is more sociable than I, but not much. I think we confuse each other because our basic drives are different, and we are looking for different things in our daily lives. Fortunately, he has a very close relationship with his mother, and so all is not lost. He and I love each other and care about each other, but there is still that wall. The problem might be my basic nature, because keeping the noisy herd at bay in life requires some work. An introvert tends to live inside a walled city in order to hold off the extroverted siege that seems to form around us. Pushing back to retain a safe space is a knee-jerk reaction. As an INTJ, I have a primary drive to learn, analyze, and understand the world, and that takes up a great deal of my time. When a person opens up to me, I can far more easily learn, analyze, and try to understand this person than I can with someone who has his own wall up. And that might be part of what happened with my younger son as well. He had his own space, and he protected it as strongly as I protected mine. Maybe this was destined to go the way it went right from the start. One of the great challenges for myself as a father was what I valued in life personally. My wife always called me Honest Abe because I valued honesty. Even being in the Navy and away from home, I never cheated on my wife. Faithfulness has always been a critical ideal for me. These things were no parental problem, because every dad should at least strive for these things. But where I struggled was what I valued so desperately in life, knowledge. I wanted to know everything. I was always reading books and studying. I calculated things, and when I got my first scientific calculator, I nearly wanted to fall down on my knees and worship. Setting aside slide rules and having a sure method of checking pencil and paper calculations was like setting down a 50-pound pack after a 10-mile hike. Suddenly, everything mathematical was much easier than it had been before. I can't even begin to express the joy I felt when that happened. But I would have even more trouble trying to get my wife and sons to share my joy in this event, and that was my problem. I approached everything as a problem in logic, a problem that needed a solution. My poor wife would bring some unhappy personal event to my attention, and what she wanted was for me to share her pain, to feel sorry for her. I did feel sorry for her, desperately. I have always felt pain when my lady is sad or hurting. But my expression of my sympathy has always been to point out solutions to the problem and methods wherein it could be made to go away. It just seems right to me that the best thing in the world that you can do to a problem is to solve it and to wipe it out of existence. Instead, my poor lady felt like I wasn't feeling properly sad about the event. I'm sure she felt I was undervaluing the level of her emotional distress. As the years went by, I was able to hold my tongue better and let her vent her frustration, and to withhold my insight into how that event could be avoided in the future, or how it could be made less painful today. It seems that sometimes feelings are all that matter, and reality, logic, solutions, and all those rigid concepts do not provide the warm, soft, fuzzy sensation that is required. I can simulate what is required many times now, even though it makes no sense to my logical mind. One of the great things about love, though, is that when the object of your love is helped to feel better, you feel better. It is not always necessary to understand the process, but sometimes you can simply enjoy the results. It was a difficult lesson for me, and it isn't completely learned even to this day, but I have made progress. This difference between the members of my family and myself has been expressed in various ways. As an example of this, my wife has told me so many times that has become a cliche in our home, "You are the smartest man I know." My younger son has said exactly the same thing in those very words a number of times. My older boy has made comments that are at least similar. Now, to anyone who is not an INTJ, this would sound like a wonderful compliment. They would feel that for me to even mention that fact would be arrogant, but they would miss the point here. This has a dark side to it as well, which was expressed by my ex-wife shortly after we had parted ways, when she said to a friend in my presence, "He's too bloody smart for me." She didn't mean it as a compliment. Understanding how that can be a slam on my value as a person helps to show why being perceived as intelligent can actually be a negative thing. I'm sure that my family actually admires my drive and desire, but they don't understand it, and it does create a wall somehow. They see my love of learning in action, and that I am constantly analyzing things and acquiring more and more of an understanding of the universe around us, and they are impressed by it, but they have absolutely no desire to join in the quest. I therefore remain forever different from them, and in a sense, this isolates me from them. Now my ESTP wife and I have found wonderful ways to bridge that gap between us. We are different in profound ways, but we have common ground that is truly wonderful. It is like two very dissimilar atoms bonding by sharing an electron or two, making for a highly stable molecule. It works, and it has worked well for over 41 years. But as an INTJ dad, the challenges are quite different. I was the adult, and they were the children, and it was up to me to resolve this great divide that came between us, thanks to my way of perceiving life. My personality demanded solitude and isolation. My family demanded interaction and understanding. What to do? Well, I did what I could and accepted that I would come up short on some things. I was never going to be the type of parent that an extroverted, fun-loving ESTP or ESFP would be. I simply didn't have that in me. Another problem I had was that when I attempted to do something to encourage some interest or other in my children, if they refused it, I backed off, and perhaps I gave up too soon. I personally react to things quickly as being interesting or uninteresting at that moment, and so I assumed this applied to my children as well. I had suffered through people forcing me to do things that I hated when I was younger, and it turned me against many of those things for life. I wanted to avoid doing that with my kids, but looking back, I think that may have been a mistake. What happened to me as a child was that I was pushed into a situation and given no setting or context for that situation. For example, my folks loved to go rock hunting, or rock hounding as Dad called it. They would drag me along, tearing me away from my space at home, and shove me into the area with the desert rocks and the tumbleweeds with no direction or explanation. I could handle being alone okay, but there was nothing to read, and while over the years I grew to love the desert, at first I hated being stuck out there with nothing to do. I didn't look for rocks because I knew nothing about rocks. They were hard and they were oddly shaped, and so what? I didn't know a jaspered agate from a chunk of granite. If Dad had taken me aside and explained some of the geology involved, it might have been a completely different thing. Today I look at the massive basalt layers in the Pacific Northwest, and I do thrill at what I see, but it is the geology and the history it shows that fascinates me. Needless to say, I never took my kids out rock hunting. I did teach my sons how to play chess, however. We spent dozens of evenings having family chess tournaments. I look back at those times fondly. I hope they do as well. I consider myself extremely fortunate as an INTJ dad that I had an ESTP wife beside me, working with me as a partner. Where I was weak, she was at her strongest. Where she was weakest, I was at my best. She was a soft, loving mother who enjoyed many kinds of games and doing fun things. I rigidly minded the rules and engaged the intellect. I never was fond of games that required chance to be in your favor to win. Sadly, I always played everything to win. At least I did before I got a granddaughter. Letting her win earns me a hug, and I would do almost anything for one of her hugs. But she is unique. Fortunately, together, my wife and I formed a fairly well-rounded parental team. I have no idea what I would have done without her. I think a little gentle pressure was in order on some of the things I could have shared with my sons. Many important things in life require a foundation to properly appreciate. You need to do some work to get to the point where you can play a musical instrument well. That work is not always fun. Running through scales over and over again and then working through easy pieces, which don't seem all that easy at first, can be difficult. Once you get over the hurdle, though, a whole world opens up to you. There are many things like this, and I feel I could have done a better job of it, and I wish I could go back and take another shot at doing some of these for my sons. This is only focused upon what goes on inside the home. I could do a whole series on the things a parent today has to deal with that are impossible to manage. The stuff that goes on in school, from the curriculum to the social norms that peers will put upon your children, will be overwhelming. If you have a TV in your home, that will dominate your child's mind. Computer video games and the internet are all ready to reprogram the value set that you are doing your best to inculcate into your child. All that you strive to accomplish, all the things that you want to teach your child about what is right and wrong, all the goals and aims you hope to help your child strive for, can be completely blown to pieces by these influences. These topics go far beyond the one I am covering in this video. In point of fact, they go far beyond what any sane parent should have to face. With all living things, we either adapt and survive, or fail to adapt and go extinct. Unlike other creatures, we can use our brains to find ways to adapt beyond what our built-in physical characteristics are capable of handling. We are dealt the cards and must play them as intelligently as we can. If we have a bad hand, we have to learn how to bluff. What we can do as parents is to use the time we are given to help our children understand life as best we can, to grasp the concepts of right and wrong, to care about other people that our children will deal with in their daily lives, while standing up for themselves and never forsaking their dignity as a person. Marcus Aurelius wrote, "If it is not right, do not do it. If it is not true, do not say it." That was good advice in the 2nd century, and it is still good advice today. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.